Okay. Well, good afternoon. My name is Joe Doucet. I'm the Dean of the College of Social Sciences and Humanities, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to this town hall. I want to begin by acknowledging that the University of Alberta resides on Treaty 6 territory, and the homeland of the Métis. This territory is a traditional gathering place for diverse Indigenous peoples whose histories, languages, and cultures continue to influence our community. To acknowledge the territory is to recognize the longer history of these lands. The acknowledgement signifies our commitment to working in good relations with First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples as we engage in our institutional work, uplifting the whole people for the University of Alberta. Now, at last count, over 400 people registered for the town hall, and I want to thank you very much for your interest. A number of questions were submitted ahead of time, and in my presentation, I'll answer some of those questions, and there will also be a Q&A, probably for about the last 30 minutes, moderated by my colleague, Dean Jennifer Tupper. And Jennifer has also received the questions that were submitted ahead of time. And you can also chat a question to Jennifer or the president's office during the call. One last point on Zoom etiquette. We're all familiar with it, but please remain on mute during the call. So in terms of the agenda, as I said, I'm aiming for about 30 minutes of Q&A. And in order for that Q&A to be productive, I've set up my presentation in three parts. I want to do a little bit of stage setting. Then I want to speak to the operating model and the college structure. And finally, I want to speak to the college team working for you. And sorry, Jasmine, if you could advance the slides, please, to number four. There we go, thank you. So the first thing to say in terms of stage setting is that at the core of the college are four great faculties with strong programs, impactful research and creative activity, and great people, our faculty, staff, students, and alumni. And so I really want to build on that great history that we have and the collaboration that exists between our faculties. Now, part of the reason that I accepted this role is that I've been a faculty member at the University of Alberta for 21 years. I'm committed to the university and to our shared mission, and I really believe that it's a privilege to have a role where I can support these great faculties. And the college will play an important role in our shared mission, and I have a lot of enthusiasm for our future. Now, I also want to acknowledge the challenges that we have all faced, the budget challenges, the pandemic challenges, and how hard everyone is working. And it's also true that we have a significant amount of uncertainty that still exists and that we're facing, and that uncertainty is not going to be resolved this week nor this year. In effect, we're really in a marathon, not a sprint. And we need to be focused on our core activities of teaching, research, and engagement. And that's certainly how I want to lead the social sciences and humanities. Next slide, please. So we in the college have an important role to play. And I really believe that we are key to our future. And when I put down those words, key to our future, I thought of the fantastic impacts that our college members, our faculty members make in society. And so there isn't a day that goes by without observations either in newspapers or other media where we hear experts in education and law, in the Faculty of Arts, in the School of Business, talking about how their research, how their teaching, how our programs is key to our future here in Alberta, but also, as I said, in Canada and more broadly. Next slide, please. So the University of Alberta for tomorrow. The University of Alberta for tomorrow is, it's important to note, a combination of two very large and significant shifts in the university. SET, the administrative restructuring, and academic restructuring. The colleges play an important role in supporting this transformation. And again, I recognize that transforming our structures is hard on us as an institution, also hard on us individually. And so we have to acknowledge all of the challenges and recognize that we have to continue to work together. Now, I've mentioned that there's significant uncertainty that we face in many dimensions of this transformation. And it's true that not all of the decisions on the processes or the changes in structures and the university have been made. And so that's really important to understand that we don't have all of the answers today about what the university is going to look like. Next slide, please. But what we do know is that we have the potential for a very exciting future. And I certainly can't predict the future, but I do know that, that the way in which teaching and learning and our teaching and learning environment has evolved is going to continue to inform our practices here at the university. And while teaching under COVID has certainly been a stress and has created a lot for our teachers and for our learners, we have learned a lot from that experience. And I expect that we will continue to integrate those learnings and integrate new ways of teaching and learning into our practices in the coming years. One of the important ambitions that the university has, and many of you have heard President Flanagan speak about this, is enrollment growth. And that's a great opportunity, but we're going to have to think carefully about how we grow our enrollments and how we adapt our structures to satisfy that enrollment growth in a way that's going to be productive again for learners and productive for our faculty and our staff. Research, innovation, and creative activity are going to continue to be at the core of what we do and at the core of what we want to continue to strive for in terms of the excellence of the institution. And finally, engagement. As I mentioned, the fantastic engagement that our faculty and staff and our students have is going to continue to be very, very important for us as we move forward. Next slide, please. So the University of Alberta for Tomorrow operating model was announced in June of this year. And that operating model is really important. In fact, it's central to outlining the roles and responsibilities, as well as the accountabilities for our university as we move forward. So the college structure is laid out in some level of detail in that. And that operating model explains how we're integrating SET and administrative restructuring into the college structure. And we're currently building on that structure with a great deal of input from our faculties and certainly from our faculty deans, but from members of faculty and staff and leaders within the university. So now let's take a look at that operating model in a little bit more detail. Next slide, please. So the first image that you have here highlights the fact that at the center of the operating model and at the center of my thinking, core academic missions of our faculty. So teaching, research, and engagement of our four fantastic faculties. So that is core and that's front of mind in what we're doing. Next slide, please. Now in green here, we've illustrated the way in which the college surrounds, and I like to think of the word supports, our faculties and those core missions. So here you have the college offices, which are under development, and they're not certainly not anywhere close to being fully developed, and they're certainly not anywhere close to being staffed right now, under development. And this is how we imagine this path forward for the college offices, and I'll just read them off here. We have research, the administrative services, education, graduate, and finally strategic initiatives that are all focused on supporting the faculties and the departments, supporting our faculty, staff, and students, and connecting our faculties and the great work that they do to the numerous university central services, whether that's administrative functions like HR and IT, or whether that's the registrar's office or others. Next slide, please. So here we've added some dark green arrows, and you see those arrows connecting the core strategic or core academic missions, I should say, to specific roles or responsibility or processes. So if we look at the one that's topmost that connects to senior partners in the VPRI, what that signifies or what that should illustrate is the way in which the college Office of Research will connect the VPRI, the Vice President Research and Innovation Office, and support research and research development within the faculties. There will shortly be a research partner appointed from the VPRI office that will serve that research office and our faculties in the college. Likewise, if we go clockwise, we see senior partners from the Vice President, University Services and Finance, and the Vice President, External Relations. And those partners in advancement, communications and marketing, finance, HR, and IT. And I'll introduce the partners that have been appointed in just a few short minutes. Next, in the Office of Education, we have senior partners appointed from the Registrar's Office in Enrollment Management and Student Recruitment. And finally, going around again clockwise, senior partners to be determined from FGSR. Again, making that connection between the Faculty of Graduate Studies and Research and our graduate programs in the faculties. I'll speak to strategic initiatives in just a second, but before I get to that, I want to highlight the fact that we will also have, go to the next slide, please. We will also have staff members eventually in the college offices. We don't have those staff members yet in strategic initiatives or grad or education or research, but eventually those will be. That there will be positions filled there, and we're not close to appointing individuals there because a lot more work needs to be done with our partners in central units and so on. As one example to come, but where we in the college really do need to work closely in collaboration with partners, both in the faculties and in other units. I want to point to strategic initiatives. So looking at about 9 o'clock on the green circle. In strategic initiatives, one of the very important areas for strategic initiatives at the university is in the area of Indigenous initiatives. And as you all know, or all should know, we're very fortunate at the university to have our colleague, Vice Provost Florence Glanfield, and Florence is also a professor in the Faculty of Education. We're very fortunate to have Indigenous program in research at the university level. And Florence and her colleagues are working at developing an Indigenous strategy for the university. And that, of course, involves a large number of colleagues across the university. And when it comes to what the faculties might do or might want the college to do in terms of Indigenous initiatives, it'll be very important for the college to be a partner, a collaborator, and a supporter of the linkages between Florence's work in a university setting and the work that's being done within our faculties and departments, the on the ground. And most obviously, the Indigenous voices at the university. It wouldn't be appropriate for the college to set out and attempt to develop an Indigenous strategy. Rather, we need to listen to the voices of our Indigenous colleagues, our Indigenous scholars, our Indigenous students within the academy, as well as supporters outside of the university, and help coordinate and hopefully develop a supportive structure within the college that can support activities within our faculties and departments. So now let me go to the next slide and begin introducing our staff or our partners within the college team. And I first want to go to the Council of Deans. So within the operating model, the Council of Deans, the deans of the faculties within the college, is an incredibly important group, a deliberative and decision-making group within the college. And I'm very fortunate to work with four fantastic leaders. And so I want to introduce them here. So I'll begin with Barb Billingsley, the Dean of the Faculty of Law. Thank you, Barb. And then Kyle Murray, the Dean of the Alberta School of Business. And I'll just wait until we can highlight Kyle. And I'm hoping that that Sheila is able to find Kyle. So there may be a technical issue. Let me see if we can turn to Steve Patton, the Dean of the Faculty of Arts. And so there seems to be a technical issue that I unfortunately am not in control of, but there's Kyle, thank you. Thanks, Kyle. And Steve, thanks very much. And finally, Jennifer Tupper, the Dean of the Faculty of Education. There we go. Sorry for that delay. So I'm really very, very fortunate to count on the collaborative spirit and the great leadership from these four colleagues leading these four great faculties. So thanks very much. Now, if I can go to the next slide and introduce my two colleagues in the Dean's Office in the college. First, Jasmine Irvin, who is the College Executive Assistant. Hi there, Jasmine. And Carrie Johnston, the College General Manager. And both, and we can't see Carrie yet. And there's Carrie. And both Carrie and Jasmine work a great deal with their colleagues in the different faculties to help coordinate the important work that we're doing in the college. So thank you very much to both of you. Now let's go to the next slide, and I want to begin to introduce the partners in the college team. So first on the administration side, HR, we have Stacy Brennan. And Stacy is a senior partner in HR. And we're just about to, there, Stacy. In finance, we have Sarah Horseman. Hello, Sarah. And Tony Currian. Hey, Tony. And in IT, we have Rob Washburn. And I think we can see Rob shortly. There we go. Hello, Rob. And as mentioned, we will soon have partners appointed in the research portfolio, in advancement and communications and marketing. And these partners are already working very, very hard in supporting the faculties through the college. And they're going to be key as we continue to evolve our administrative and academic structures to better serve our staff and faculty members. Let's go to the next slide. And within our Office of Education, we have two partners. Sarah Peterson, our recruitment partner from the Registrar's Office. And there's Sarah. Hi there, Sarah. And we have Jennifer Alabiso from the also from the Registrar's Office, who's responsible for enrollment management. Jennifer. There we go. Hi, Jennifer. These types of meetings will be much smoother when we can get back in person. I'm sure you'll all agree. So on the next slide, last introduction, I want to introduce Richard Field, the Academic Director of the Peter Lougheed Leadership College. And as most of you should know, the Peter Lougheed Leadership College until this July 1st, and there is Richard. Hello, Richard. The Peter Lougheed Leadership College, until this July 1st, was under the Provost's Office. And with the creation of the colleges, the decision was made to move PLLC to the College of Social Sciences and Humanities. And I really want to thank Richard for taking on the leadership of the PLLC. Next slide, please. So, Now that we've gone through this diagram once and we've introduced a number of individuals who are working in support of the faculties through these offices, I just want to highlight a little bit of what this means in terms of service for the faculties and how we really believe this will be a good model for us to move forward. It's a new model, so it does mean that people are looking sometimes in different places logistically for answers and getting help from different individuals and different processes. But if I think about the senior partners in the Office of Education, if we think about enrollment management, what is going to happen is, as we look forward, and we're already obviously planning for enrollment in the fall of 2022. And so Jennifer and her colleagues are able now through the college and the college structure to work a little bit more effectively with the different faculties in our college and connect those faculties to the registrar's office in the hopes that we are able to make, better decisions, more timely decisions, and also have better information flows and better communication across our different faculties. So rather than the registrar's office dealing with 16 different faculties somewhat independently and sometimes maybe a little bit chaotically, I'm not sure if that's an appropriate way to talk about how things may have happened. And quite honestly, we still have to deal with a lot of bumps along the road. But as we think about enrollment and particularly enrollment growth in the coming years, it's going to be even more important that we have a cohesive institutional view. And within our going to be really important that the faculties have an opportunity and the structures that enable them to work together to look at enrollment and the impacts of enrollment and enrollment changes on other faculties. So that's one way to look at this graph. And again, I want to highlight what I said earlier about strategic initiatives and the fact that what we're going to do in strategic initiatives is connecting the faculties to each other and to other units such as Florence Glanfield's portfolio on Indigenous programming and research. So if we can move to the next slide, please. As I've said several times, we are not done yet. This is a marathon. There's a lot of work to do. So in terms of ongoing college development, I introduced the Council of Deans, and the Council of Deans gets together weekly now. Kerry Johnston, our college general manager, works with the faculty general managers and meets regularly and frequently with them. In addition, within the college, we have some very active and hardworking working groups in the areas of grad, education, research, and EDI. And practically all of the other units at the university continue to work on these restructuring paths with the focus and the goal on developing more efficiency and certainly improving the teaching, research, and other activities that we have. So I just want to highlight that SET is not finished yet. We expect most of the set objectives to be met by the end of this fiscal year. The pro working group on the academic leaders task group and that work continues, and that's going to be an important input into college developments. And other units, including FGSR, UAI, and others, continue to work on this restructuring. Next slide, please. So with that, I want to thank you very much for attending this town hall. I want to thank you for all of the hard work that I know that each and every one of you is doing and all of your efforts for the university. Communication is going to be important as we move forward. So please don't hesitate to reach out to me. You can see my address here on my email address here on the slide. Send me an email. I will answer you. I will get back to you. I would like to plan another town hall probably for late November in order to give some updates and again, take more questions. But that is all that I wanted to say at this point. So I'd like now to turn things over to my colleague, Jennifer Tupper, and I thank Jennifer for accepting my request to moderate the Q&A. And a reminder that Jennifer has The questions that were submitted ahead of time, but if you would like to chat a question to Jennifer, please do so through the Zoom chat function. You can send it either directly to Jennifer Tupper or to the president's office, and it will be forwarded to Jennifer. So with that, I think we can now, or I can now turn things over to Jennifer. Over to you.
Thanks, Joe. And it's good to have so many people participating in this town hall. So we do have questions coming in on the chat, and I will get to those. But I also have a series of questions that were submitted in advance. And I am going to begin with one of those, Joe. So the question is, what, if any, functions related to graduate program administration currently conducted by FGSR will move to the college?
So great question. And I think that the issue of grad studies and the administration of grad studies, I know that that's one of the issues that a lot of people are concerned about. I can't tell you, unfortunately, this is one of the areas where decisions still have to be made. So I can't tell you what changes are going to be brought to FGSR, but I can tell you that what is going to stay in the faculties and departments is the set of activities very closely tied to the academic mission of faculties and departments. So the academic, disciplinary, advising, and those kinds of things will remain in faculties and departments. It's not clear yet how the administrative functions, all the administrative functions associated with recruitment, enrollment, and those things will move. And that's something that depends on other decisions that are made outside of the college. So I wish I had more information on that one, because I know that it is an area of significant interest for everyone. And I hope that we see more clarity in the next couple of months.
Thanks, Joe. I'm going to take a question from the chat now. And I know this is one that certainly has come up in our faculty as well. So Joe, if you could speak to how student services are going to fit into the college model, that would be great.
Yes. So similar to, and another important question that I appreciate, and similar to my last answer, in my mind, the student services closely tied to academic disciplines, academic advising, where faculty members' expertise is really central and critical to the students. That's going to remain in the faculties, and we want to support that. The work associated with supporting students, either in the student services office or other work that is less closely tied to the discipline. So if we think about more general career development that might not be discipline tied, that could be more general in terms of social science students and so on, those are the types of things that may be at the college or may be more centralized in student services or things in the RO or the Dean of Student Offices.
Thanks, Joe. And this is from the list of questions submitted in advance. And the question is, how can we ensure that the new administrative layer that the college creates doesn't simply duplicate the meetings, processes, and decisions that are already occurring at departmental and faculty levels?
So really important question, and I can say, and Jennifer, you heard this at Dean's Council this morning, one of the key principles that all the deans and the provost and president are very supportive of is the elimination of duplication. So what we really want to do is eliminate having the same function in different places so that people have to do the same thing twice. So at a general, is one of the important principles in the creation of the college, that we streamline things so that we don't have duplication, and ultimately so that our faculty members can do the things that are high value, the things that they have always wanted to do as highly valued academics. And that's focus on their teaching, on student engagement, on research and creative activity.
Thanks, Joe. And there are two questions that are both asking for some clarification. So I'm going to ask them both, and then you can respond to each, Joe, and they are in the chat. So the first is a clarification around the service partners and how are they, please clarify what is meant by partners. Are they external appointments, a new layer of governance? Could this be explained? And then the second clarification is an explanation of what is meant by the Office of Education.
Okay. So on the first one, and I see some of the partners on my screen here, and on the first one, those senior partners, this is part of the restructuring of those administrative functions. So I'm looking at Sarah Horseman and Tony Currian, who I see on my screen here. Within the SET initiative, the management of our financial world at the university, the financial transactions, has been significantly reworked or reimagined. And as a result, rather than having finance people within faculties, we now have a couple of different changes. We have transactional hubs, and I apologize to my colleagues, I'm not using the right word, but that's the one I have in mind, the transactional hubs where transactions get processed, and that's kind of behind the wall someplace. Sarah and Tony, and maybe I would ask Sarah to jump in after I finish this quick explanation to add or correct things that I may misstate. But Sarah and Tony, their job is to be the link between what goes on and what is needed in the faculties and what gets done in terms of processes in the transaction hub or policies. And as an example, a problem comes up, say, with purchasing equipment. Clear what needs to be done. It's not clear who needs to be talked to in terms of the contract and so on. Sarah may be the person who helps figure that out. Again, so the faculty member does not have to spend time worrying about how that gets organized. So these are new positions, new roles. Both Sarah and Tony are longtime U of A employees. They applied for these roles, were successful in the competitions, and they're now in our college to serve our faculty, our faculties on the finance side. Sarah, please correct anything that I've misstated or said incorrectly.
No, that was exactly right. The only other thing I'd add is that there is the finance partners that are similar to Tony and I. They report centrally, but are located within the faculties as well. And they are your contact people. And if they're not sure, they come to us. So there's multiple layers of support here that are ready to help any faculty member who's struggling with anything. And that's on the finance side.
Thank you. And very, very good catch. I should have mentioned the finance partners in the faculty. So thank you. Thank you for that, Sarah. So I think that answers, or I hope, Jennifer, that answers the first. In terms of the Office of Education, if you look at the operating model, there's a list of the responsibilities for that Office of Education. And again, at the present time, what we have, or the activities that we have there, are recruitment with Sarah Peterson, and enrollment management with Jennifer Alibiso. And other things that will be added there include work integrated learning, include student discipline, and things like that. So again, trying to take activities that are mostly currently located in the faculties and some faculty offices and push them up to the college in an effort to standardize, harmonize, and get more efficiency and better service for our faculties. So the Office of Education, I will also say, I'm not thrilled with that title. Education is somewhat general. It's not clear exactly what that means, as opposed to, say, research, where it's pretty clear what that one means. And I don't know if we'll change that title in the future, but it mostly refers to those things: recruitment, enrollment, work integrated learning, and so on.
Thanks, Joe. Next question from the chat. How will you soften the hierarchies and administrative stratification, particularly for chairs? Will the working groups include chairs and professoriate levels in their representation?
So really good question. At the present time, the working groups have representatives from each of the faculties. And if I think about the research working group, it began with the associate dean's research of the four faculties, really talking about the research need, how the VPRI can work better with the faculties and what the college can do there. But I think it's a really good suggestion. I take it as a suggestion from the question that as we move forward, getting more representation, more voices, and more input is going to be a good idea in those different offices. And rest assured that I look forward to having more of our colleagues, people on this call and others, participate in some of those discussions, because there'll be a lot of details to sort out. And it will be really important to have broad input and representation in those working groups. So I'm noting that. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. And so many great questions coming into the chat. So the next one that I will pose to you is specific to interdisciplinarity. And the question is, we've been told that the creation of the colleges was driven by the need for interdisciplinarity. How is interdisciplinarity going to inform the operations of the college?
So really good question. Those of you who followed the General Faculties Council, GFC, will be aware of some of the discussions at GFC on interdisciplinarity, on interdisciplinary metrics, and how important that is. And certainly if you've heard President Flanagan talk about the colleges, he certainly talks a lot about interdisciplinarity. The first thing I want to say is that our college already has a great deal of interdisciplinary scholarship and work. So it's not as if we're starting from zero. I want to acknowledge and recognize that we have a lot of colleagues in each of our four faculties who are very actively engaged with colleagues and graduate students in other faculties and other disciplines. So there's already a lot of work being done. Secondly, I think that bringing us together in a college is going to continue to help us see more opportunities. So as an example, when the senior research partner is appointed, I expect that person will in effect be able to inform a lot of our colleagues more quickly and help support research projects, grant opportunities, and others that are more interdisciplinary in nature, just because of the opportunity of getting together more. Now, the last thing I'll say is that this in no way should be interpreted as limiting or constraining any of the great work that people are doing now. It's not an obligation. So our faculty members are certainly today and will continue to be free to pursue and explore their research, their creative activities in the ways that they see fit. But we're really talking about hopefully developing more opportunities that allow people to take advantage of connections, of resources, of grad students, and so on, in order to help them flourish.
Thanks, Joe. And there's quite a few questions coming in from staff that are similar in nature. So I'm going to try to encapsulate them into a single question, and recognizing that our staff have been the most impacted by the administrative restructuring and, of course, have lots of questions and uncertainties around their roles. So the question is broadly, how will support staff be moved from the faculty level to the college level when decisions are made about what staff functions will sit at the college level? What will the process be? Will staff have an opportunity to apply for those roles? Will they move automatically? So any insight you can share about that, Joe, would be appreciated.
Yeah, so that is a great question. That's a question, Jennifer, that we have heard for some time now associated with many of these changes with SET. And I'll say that a very important principle for the university in all of these changes has been creating opportunities for our staff members to apply for positions, to have access to new positions as they're created. So I fully expect that as we create positions in the in the college, our staff members from across the university will an equal opportunity. And for the most part, most of these positions to date have been filled by internal hires. So I expect that to continue, that people will be able to apply for these positions. And that's what we'll do. I don't know if Stacy, I hope that Stacy Brennan is still on the call. And I just asked Stacy to pop up and as a senior HR partner, either complete or correct me, please. Always, if I misstate something, correct me. So Stacy, do you want to add anything to that?
I do have to apologize, Joe. I just had to deal with my sick child, so I missed the question.
So the question that Jennifer asked was, as positions are created in the college, how will they be filled? And I just spoke to the principle of open competitions within the university and so on. So,
yeah, absolutely. They will be through a fair and complete process. There are internal processes that we are following to make sure that internals are given priority on positions prior to externals coming in. So we do want to continue to emphasize that, but otherwise it will be fair and competitive process for any vacant positions. So I think you've spoken fairly.
Stacy, thanks so much, and I hope your child gets better and feels better soon. Jennifer, back to you.
Yeah, thanks, Joe. So you referenced earlier in your presentation the working groups, and there was a request for you to elaborate and provide some updates on the working groups. What is done there, who is involved to date, and what will be done in the future, and who will be involved from faculties? So many questions all rolled into one.
Yeah, so thank you. So as I mentioned, we to date have four working groups in grad, research, education, and EDI. So let me speak to, and recognizing the time, we have 15 minutes left, I'll try to be relatively brief to allow for more questions. But each of those groups, for each of those groups, I asked the four faculty deans to nominate or suggest individuals who would be the most appropriate to begin the discussions on the working groups and the roles of the offices for the college. So the four deans were asked, for instance, on the grad side, who should be present? And each of the four deans suggested a graduate associate dean or equivalent. And we've had discussions looking at the operating model, in that case, looking at the operating model, looking at FGSR. And it's also an opportunity for the colleagues from the different faculties to get together, and they already do. So again, this is not as if it's creating new conversations or only new conversations that didn't exist, but it allows them to think about some of the ways forward that we maybe haven't thought of previously. So as we're looking to make changes to other university structures, or as the provost is convening members of the university community to speak about academic leadership changes at the university, this allows us to look to those colleagues in the working group and get their ideas, their input, put them to work a little bit in terms of coming up with suggestions and ideas that might move us forward. Now we possibly could have added more people to those working groups. We didn't do that just yet. Let me jump then to the EDI working group. As we talked about EDI, we had some really interesting conversations about equity, diversity, and inclusion, and Indigenous initiatives. And Jennifer, you'll recall that at the Council of Deans, we had a conversation about how this, and the message that I got very clearly was that we needed to, while recognizing the relationships between equity, diversity, and inclusion and Indigenous initiatives, we really needed to keep those separate as two separate types of conversations, related but separate. And so we haven't yet created any kind of structure on the Indigenous initiatives front, so we don't have a working group there, but that may be something that will come up in the coming months. And for that one, I'd look to colleagues, Indigenous colleagues and Indigenous voices within our faculties to help inform me and the Council of Deans as to what to do there. Jennifer, did I answer the questions, or is there a missing piece there?
No, I think you answered the question, and there of course continue to be many more questions coming into the chat, and I apologize in advance that I will not be able to get to everyone's question today, which suggests that we probably need another opportunity in the not too distant future for these conversations. So there is one more staff question that I'm going to pose, and then a faculty question, because I do think staff members are seeking some clarity. So Joe, can you speak at all about where student advisors will be situated? Will they move up to the college level to achieve some of those economies of scale or efficiencies that have been discussed, or will they be maintained in the faculty, or will it be a combination therein?
So, really good question, and I appreciate the anxiety that people feel in those roles right now. I can't speak to a decision or a path at this point, Jennifer, because I don't think those decisions have been made yet. There are still ongoing conversations in a number of different places, including the Student Services Center, the Registrar's Office, and other places. So, what I'll put out there again is the general principle that advising that is very discipline specific and relies very much on that disciplinary knowledge is more than likely to stay within the faculties. Advising that is more general and can be centralized in some way to provide efficiency. And when I say efficiency, please understand that it's much, much more than just dollars and cents efficiency. It's student-focused efficiency that will give students better access to answers more quickly and so on. And that's the idea behind the Student Services Center, to really respond to student needs more quickly, more seamlessly, more effectively. And something else to say is that, you know, for some of you who've maybe heard our registrar, Melissa Padfield, talk about the Student Services Center over the last 2 years, one of the really important features or thinking behind the Student Services Center is the continued improvement process of helping those centralized student support staff members continue to engage with faculty and department level student supporters so that there's an exchange of information so that people can either have the information more quickly or direct students on where to go more quickly. So unfortunately, you know, this is one of the areas, Jennifer, where the decisions haven't all been made. And so we certainly don't know exactly where some of those roles are going to go. But I think that general principle is going to continue to apply.
Thanks, Joe. I appreciate that some of the details are still being worked out, but I think it's important for staff to be able to raise these questions.
Absolutely.
So the next question, as I said, is a faculty-related question. Does the new model make faculty council obsolete? Is there a decision-making role for faculty members at the college level? Where will decisions get made?
So I'm happy to finally get an answer where or a question where I can be definitive. So are faculty councils obsolete? Absolutely positively no. The governance structure of faculty councils remains in place. FEC remains in place. The college is not a substitute in any way for that academic decision making that's enshrined in our governance and has not changed. So faculty councils still absolutely have their role in all the decisions that they make in terms of programs and so on. Faculty FECs, faculty evaluation committees still have their role. Faculty deans have their role in terms of chairing FEC in the cases where deans chair FEC, leading faculty councils, making hiring decisions and academic decisions that are the purview of the faculties.
Thanks, Joe. The next question is specific to where continuing education and lifelong learning might fit into the college.
So great question. So as many of you will know, our faculty of extension is evolving. The academic tenure track faculty members from extension were moved to different faculties, some of them in this college. Wendy Rogers, our deputy provost, is now the acting dean of the faculty of extension. And Wendy and others in Central, with a lot of support from many, some people on this call and others in the faculties, are developing a university strategy for continuing professional education. And so I expect more news on that in the coming year, but I certainly hope that the development of a central office for continuing professional education will be of service to all of our faculties, developing new opportunities. And I'm not sure if there will be a role for the college, but there may well be a role for the college, again, in bridging that link between a central service and the faculty. So more on that, but there certainly will be changes to continuing in professional education at the university, and a lot of work is being done on that.
Yeah, thanks, Joe. This question asks you to comment on what you see as the biggest challenges for the college over the next couple of years and how you envision mitigating the risk.
So great question. So I guess you're asking what wakes me up at 3 a.m, basically. And that there are a few levels to my answer. So first of all, in terms of challenges, is supporting set and the administrative restructuring so that we get that right, so that we move as quickly as possible to a high-performing set of services that allows our faculty, our staff, and our students to do the specialized work that they really want to do, as opposed to getting caught up in bureaucratic challenges and so on. So helping the college or having the college help in that set process. Secondly, setting up all of the academic offices. We talked about the challenges of the Office of Education or the grad office, the research office, and all those special initiatives. So setting that up as quickly as possible, and quite honestly, convincing the people on this call that there is value there. I believe that we are going to be able to demonstrate value. And I also recognize that with all the challenges that we've had over the last 18 or 24 months, that there's a lot of apprehension, there's a lot of concern and worry, and there's a lot of a wait and see. So really being able to convince people that the colleges actually are delivering on that support for the academic mission. And then that would get us out, say, 5 years from now to a new functioning model at the university where we can grow our enrollment develop new programs, really contribute to that learning environment, and do even better on the research and creative activity side.
Thanks, Joe. And I will, excuse me, we'll ask one more question because I think we are almost out of time. And this is one that hasn't been discussed very much at all, but I think is on people's minds. And that is what role the colleges will play in supporting international initiatives and what will be the intersection with UAI on those?
Again, another good question. And the international set of issues is a big one. And it's one that we've talked a little bit about at the university in the last 18 months, mostly in light of the pandemic and the impact that's had on travel and research travel, international students and those things. But I'll say that it's more of a question mark. For me, it's more of a question mark than a definitive answer, because I don't know yet how changes might come about at UAI, how that will be integrated into the college and the faculty activities. So I think we need to see what might happen at UAI, how that fits into our plans for enrollment growth, how that fits into other global issues such as the pandemic and the recovery from the pandemic and those kinds of things. So I don't have a good sense now, but I will say that again, the way in which I like to think about international, like so many of these issues, is it's first and foremost a faculty issue. So if I'm looking at you, Jennifer, how can the faculty of education benefit from more or different international engagement, international activities, and how can the college support you as Dean of Education and your colleagues in the Faculty of Education in doing those great things that you want to do? So I always bring this back to the college supporting the faculties and helping the faculties do even more of the great things that you're doing.
Thanks, Joe. And I think we're probably out of time for the remainder of the questions.
So Jennifer, thank you so much for moderating, and I really appreciate the way you organized and picked out the questions. For everyone on the call, all of the questions that were submitted through the chat are going to be saved and they'll be communicated to us, so we will get those questions. I will look at the questions and see if we can generate some answers to those in terms of follow-up. I'll certainly take stock of those for development of the college. And I certainly hope that we can have another town hall like this, and probably with more time for Q&A now that we've gone through some of the introductory notions of the college. And as I mentioned, maybe sometime in November, and Jennifer, you spoke about, you know, the large number of questions and the desire that was expressed for communication and so on. So hopefully we'll be able to do this. I say hopefully, I should be able to decide. So I guess I will decide that we'll do this in November. We'll find a time that is convenient, and then we'll communicate that to everyone. So with that, I want to thank everyone on the call. I want to thank the staff who managed the call, and Jasmine in my office who managed the flipping of the slides. I want to thank our two ASL interpreters. Thank you very much for your support. Thanking everyone who's on the call and all the folks that I introduced and everyone who's working hard. And I want to wish you all a good rest of your week. I hope that everyone has an opportunity to relaxation, some time off this coming weekend, and that you enjoy a happy and healthy Thanksgiving. So with that, thanks very much. Take care, everybody.